everyone. Welcome to this session on muscles of the upper limb. In this session, we'll be learning about the muscles of the hand. Okay, you see, muscles of the hand, they are in all 20 in number. We can group them into groups of 4. There are 4 thenar muscles, 4 hypothenar muscles, 4 lumbricals, 4 palmar introsii, and 4 dorsal introsii. Okay, so these 20 muscles we'll be covering in this particular session. So let's start with the thenar muscles first. In muscles of the hand, we need not remember all the attachments of the muscles like as we do for the muscles of the forearm, the remaining of the upper limb. In muscles of the hand, we at least need to remember the names of the muscles and the approximate location of those muscles. Okay. So thenar muscles, these are 4 in number: adductor pollicis, abductor pollicis brevis, flexor pollicis brevis, and opponens pollicis. So how we can easily remember these 4 muscles? We can remember 4 actions of the thumb. Okay, which 4 actions? So you can do these actions as I'm speaking: adduction, abduction, flexion, and opposition. Okay, these 4 actions, if you remember, then you can correlate and easily remember the names of the muscles. The muscles are 4 in number, but these 3 muscles are together included in the thenar eminence. These 3 muscles are included in thenar eminence: abductor pollicis brevis, flexor pollicis brevis, and opponens pollicis. Adductor pollicis is a deep muscle. It's not included in the thenar eminence. So to identify these muscles, in the superficial part, there are 2 muscles which are seen. Abductor pollicis brevis is on the lateral aspect. Flexor pollicis brevis is on the medial aspect. When we retract these 2 muscles, in a deeper plane, a muscle will be seen. Here, this is opponens pollicis. Okay, this is opponens. And a horizontal muscle which is seen here, it has got a transverse head and an oblique head. This muscle is adductor pollicis. Okay. These are the thenar muscles. Let's try to identify these muscles in the dissected image. So this muscle here is abductor pollicis brevis. This muscle is flexor pollicis brevis. If we retract these 2 muscles, the muscle lying deep will be opponens pollicis. And here, this muscle which we can see, this is adductor pollicis, the transverse head and oblique head. Okay, this is adductor pollicis muscle. Now let's cover the hypothenar muscles as well as the lumbricals. So hypothenar muscles are seen here on the medial side. In hypothenar muscles, the muscles are towards the little finger. That's why digiti minimi comes in the name. There is abductor digiti minimi, flexor digiti minimi, opponens digiti minimi, as well as there is one superficial muscle just beneath the skin in this region, that is palmaris brevis muscle. Okay. To remember these muscles also, we can remember actions of this little finger: abduction, flexion, and opposition. So 3 muscles are seen in the image, and one muscle is just beneath the skin, that is palmaris brevis. Then let's see the lumbricals. Lumbricals are 4 in number. They are attached onto the tendons of the flexor digitorum profundus muscle. This is the first lumbrical, second, third, and fourth. Okay. If you carefully see, the first and the second lumbricals are unipinnate muscles, and the third and the fourth lumbricals are bipinnate muscles. Distal attachment, it goes up to the dorsal digital expansion. Nerve supply of lumbricals is such that the first and the second lumbricals, which are on the lateral aspect, those are supplied by the median nerve, and the third and the fourth lumbricals, which are on the medial aspect, those are supplied by the ulnar nerve. Because as we all know, the flexor digitorum profundus muscle, its lateral half is supplied by median nerve and the medial half is supplied by the ulnar nerve. Okay, similarly it carries forward for the lumbricals as well. For hypothenar muscles, all are supplied by the ulnar nerve. Okay, maximum muscles in the hand are supplied by ulnar nerve. Only few of them are supplied by median nerve, which I'll list out at the end of the session. Let's see dissected images of these muscles. So here, these muscles are the hypothenar muscles. This is abductor digiti minimi. This is flexor digiti minimi. Opponent's digiti minimi will be a little in a little deeper plane. Okay, and with the skin, the palmaris brevis muscle has been gone. Okay, and these muscles, as you can see, these are the lumbricals. Lumbricals means worm-like muscles. Okay, this is the first lumbrical, second, third, and fourth lumbricals. The proximal attachment is on the tendons of the flexor digitorum profundus muscle. Distal attachment is it goes up to the dorsal digital expansion. Now let's cover the other set of muscles, the palmar introsciae and the dorsal introsciae. Palmar introsciae will be seen more clearly on the anterior aspect. Dorsal introsciae will be seen more clearly from the posterior aspect. Okay, in this image we can see the palmar introsciae. This first, second, third, and fourth. There is no palmar introsciae which is attached onto the middle metacarpal. Okay, because this is the axis of movement. The movements caused by these muscles are adduction and abduction. For hand adduction and abduction, the axis is towards the middle finger. Okay, movement towards the middle finger is adduction. Movement away from the middle finger is abduction. So palmar introsciae causes adduction. You can remember pad. And dorsal introsciae causes abduction. You can remember dab. Okay, dorsal introsciae is for abduction. Palmar introsciae is for adduction. In this image, we can see the dorsal introsciae. Dorsal introsciae are bipinnate muscles arising from the adjacent metacarpals. Distal attachment, it goes up to the base of the proximal phalanx as well as onto the dorsal digital expansion. And all muscles are supplied by ulnar nerve. Action of these lumbricals and introsciae are such that they cause flexion of the metacarpophalangeal joint and extension at the interphalangeal joints. Okay. So when they are paralyzed, opposite action occurs, which leads to a clinical condition which is called as claw hand. In claw hand, there is hyperextension of the metacarpophalangeal joint and flexion of the interphalangeal joints. Exactly opposite the actions of these introsciae and lumbricals. Okay. Let's see the dissected images of palmar introsciae and dorsal introsciae. These are the palmar introsciae. As you can see, there is no palmar introsciae attached onto the middle metacarpal. Okay, and these are the dorsal introsciae. Let's summarize what we have covered in this session. So in all, as you all know, there are 20 muscles grouped into groups of four thenar, four hypothenar, lumbricals, palmar introsciae, and dorsal introsciae. Okay, each of them are four in number, and the nerve supply of these muscles is such that 16 and a half is supplied by ulnar nerve and 4.5 is supplied by median nerve. Okay, so if you remember this 4.5 part, then remaining muscles we can add on to the ulnar nerve. So what is this half half is from the flexor pollicis brevis muscle. Okay, flexor pollicis brevis is a hybrid muscle supplied by both median nerve and ulnar nerve. And which are the other four muscles which are supplied by median nerve? Two are the lumbricals. First and the second lumbricals are supplied by median nerve, and there are two muscles in the thenar eminence, opponens pollicis and abductor pollicis brevis. Okay, abductor pollicis brevis, opponens pollicis, these are two other muscles. So these two and these two lumbricals and half of flexor pollicis brevis, only this much in the hand is supplied by median nerve. Rest all muscles are supplied by ulnar nerve. For lumbricals, palmar introsciae and dorsal introsciae, actions are very important because they get affected in a clinical condition which is called as clump case paralysis. So actions of lumbricals, palmar and dorsal introsciae are flexion of the metacarpophalangeal joint and extension of the interphalangeal joint. And exactly opposite will occur in a clinical condition which is called as claw hand due to the lower trunk of the brachial plexus injury, called as clump case paralysis. In claw hand, what occurs? Hyperextension of the metacarpophalangeal joint and flexion of the interphalangeal joint. Okay, so all these occur in claw hand. So this was all about this particular session. If you all have any doubts, then you all can ask in the comments section below. Okay, thank you.